Hello, everyone. I'm John Leyendecker, Editor-in-Chief of Reckonry Review, the journal otherwise known as R3. And I am here today with Dr. Myles Taffel, Associate Section Chief of Abdominal Imaging and Professor of Radiology at NYU. Welcome, Myles.
Thank you for having me, John.
Today, we are going to be discussing your article recently published in R3 entitled Incidental Splenic Lesions, an Algorithm for Assessment and Management. But before we get started with the specifics of splenic lesions, perhaps you could tell us a little bit about how you got interested in the spleen.
Yeah, so my flirtation with the spleen has been a long-standing affair. It actually goes back all the way to when I was a fellow at Northwestern about 15 years ago. And one of my mentors there, Paul Nicolaitis, recommended that I look into organs that are largely neglected as potential areas of opportunity in body imaging. The spleen was the first one that came to his mind. So then I embarked on doing extensive, you know, searches of the archives at Northwestern on the spleen, and basically found that I could encounter nothing with pathologic confirmation. So knowing that it was hard to teach people or learn about the spleen when you never knew what the lesion really was, I kind of put it to the side.
So what makes the imaging diagnosis of a splenic lesion so challenging?
Well, so the good news in that regard is that most of them are benign. The bad news is that almost everything looks alike. So, you know, in the course of the paper, we kind of start to talk about things that can help you decide not necessarily what an exact diagnosis is in the spleen, but what to do next with it in terms of how to manage it, whether it's just leave it alone, never worry about it again, or push your referring clinicians to go straight to some kind of intervention, or just surveil it.
If my radiologist were to find a 1 to 2 centimeter incidental splenic lesion on my CT scan, how worried should I be?
Well, of course, we've got to look at that in context of what the imaging findings are, but overall, not much. So, you know, I like to use the analogy for another organ that I like, the adrenal gland. And really, in both of these organs, the likelihood of having a malignancy, especially in a patient with no known history of a cancer, so basically eliminating the opportunity that this is a metastasis or decreasing the risk for it to be a metastasis, it's very, very low that you would have a primary splenic malignancy. And just on that same notion, in the face of Mets, you almost basically never have isolated splenic metastases. So if you were to look around the rest of the abdomen and don't see metastases elsewhere, it's unlikely that that splenic lesion is from represents metastasis from somewhere else.
What types of splenic lesions do you feel confident diagnosing with imaging?
One, obviously, a purely cystic lesion. I may not know exactly what it is, but I know not to worry about it. You know, it's, I mean, pretty much there's a couple different things in a cystic splenic lesion differential, but almost all of them are benign, you know. And then things like hamartomas, which look a lot like background splenic parenchyma, I feel like you can make those pretty confidently, especially if they're homogeneous. And then SANT is another lesion where if you see the presence of iron and it has the other classic imaging characteristics, you can make that diagnosis pretty confidently as well.
So what features of a splenic lesion make you more concerned about malignancy?
A lot of irregularity, things like necrosis, and regularity in terms of the margins. And certainly if it's extending outside the capsule into other organs. Heterogeneity as well, but we have to be a little careful with heterogeneous. That's such a subjective term. We certainly see some degrees of heterogeneity in things like a hemangioma. So although that's a feature that's classically described, that one gets a little bit more nuanced.
If you choose to follow a splenic lesion that you think is probably benign, how long do you need to follow it for to be certain it isn't something to worry about?
Well, so after 12 months of stability, and I would define stability of growth of 3 millimeters or less, because they can grow a little bit, that's okay, then you can feel very confident that the lesion you're looking at is benign.
Did you see the 1999 film Mystery Men?
Mystery Men? No, I didn't. And I see a lot of movies. I see a lot of movies. And who's in that?
In the movie, Paul Rubens, a.k.a. Pee Wee Herman, plays a character called the spleen whose only superpower was emitting foul odors.
It's another example of slander against the spleen, which has been going on for ages. Actually, you can trace the slander of the spleen all the way back to Pliny the Elder, who was a Roman philosopher who wrote this compendium called Naturalis Historia, in which he said that the spleen actually hindered athletes. And based on that, there were all these different treatments for athletes to help them perform better, including application of leeches and left upper quadrant cauterization. So even today, like you can see, the spleen just gets a bad rap. If anything, the spleen should help with your odor because it's a cleansing mechanism.
In your article, you propose a very pragmatic classification scheme for incidental splenic lesions discovered on CT. Do you have any plans now to validate your proposed system?
Yes. Actually, great question. I know that everyone in radiology is always looking for another RAD system because there's not enough of them out there. But this, I think there is a utility to something like this. The spleen specifically is an organ we frequently don't know what to do with lesions. So we do have plans to try to do this, to have this validated at multiple institutions. My co-authors, who were very helpful in this, in setting up this algorithm, we plan on doing it at the institutions, and there's six of them, I believe, that we'll be participating. So more on that to come.